Well, I am so glad everyone is here. Let's prepare our hearts to go to the Lord's table. I hope you have some cracker and some juice that you can participate with us. And I want to talk a little about, what do you think the Lord's table has anything to do? You know, are you covered by the blood of Christ? In 2 Corinthians 4, verse 11, For if what is passed away was glorious, what remains is much more glorious. Therefore, since we have such hope, we use great boldness of speech, unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look steady at the end of what was passing away. We are not looking at the end here. We're looking at a future. We know that Jesus Christ died on the cross, and we know that he rose again on the third day. And Jesus says, do this in remembrance of him. So we take the bread, we break it, we take the cup, and we drink it. But it is things that we are to remember. It is things that we need to have faith in. Are we looking towards the Lord? Are we hiding behind a veil? Moses had to hide behind a veil because the glory of the Lord was in his face. Today, the glory of the Lord should be in our hearts, and people should see us. So we come here at this table to remember what Jesus Christ did and what the cost was that we can be called children of God. And it was interesting. He sat there. He taught his disciples for 3.5 years. And on the night just before he was betrayed, he took the bread and he says, this is my body that is broken for you. He said this because his body was going to be broken. His body was going to be broken for us. Have you been broken by the power of the blood of Jesus? Have you been broken so that you know that all your brokenness has been healed by what Jesus Christ did? That's what this broken body and that's what this bread represents. So church, let us partake. Likewise, he picked up the cup and says, this is the cup, the new covenant. Are you members of this new covenant? Are you still living in the old? I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. And I believe that his broken body was for me. And I believe that this cup washes my sins away. So church, as we prepare to take of this cup, let's bow our heads. Oh, Heavenly Father, Lord, I do come to you. Lord, I do ask that your light will shine in my life, that people could clearly see Jesus in me. Lord, I take this cup in remembrance of what you did for the remission of sins. Lord, I thank you for this cup. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Church, let us partake. Thank you for being part of communion. Stay tuned and let us worship God.
I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Welcome back. I'm so glad that you're here with us today. If you'd open up your Bibles to Matthew chapter 6, we're going to start on verse 5 through 13. But today I'd like to talk about the discipline of personal prayer. How many of us have a discipline and a routine that we pray? How many of us actually go to the Lord with prayer, with expectation? Or are we just rambling words? Or are we just repeating something that we were taught? So I want to talk a little bit about the discipline of personal prayer. As we develop the core of disciplines of our sincere faith, we must include the work on our prayer. Our prayer life must also be part of our discipleship in training in understanding the Word of God, but also in our prayer life. Even those of us who have grown up around praying people need instruction. I grew up in church, my parents were pastors, and we prayed all the time, but we still needed instruction for prayer. And who better to talk to us about the prayer than Matthew 6? And if you've seen most of your Bible, sometimes the heading is the Lord's Prayer. You know, you realize that the 12 original disciples spent 3 years, 3.5 years hanging out with Jesus. They watched him and they traveled with him. They listened to him and they were hanging around him. They were always there. But I have not found, and maybe I'm wrong. If you find it, please call me at First Christian Church. But I have not found any place in scriptures that the disciples came to the Lord and said, Lord, teach us to teach. Give me an instruction on how to present the gospel. Teach me how to teach. I have not been able to find that. I do know that he taught. Even though he was the master teacher, he spent 3.5 years teaching them. But not once did they say that, Lord, teach us how to do miracles either. Have you noticed that the miracles that Jesus did and the disciples were there? But they didn't say, Lord, teach us how to do these miracles. Now, they did ask, why didn't this work? Because they automatically assumed that how they were going to do it, it was going to work. Now, we do know in scriptures that Jesus had to tell them that this kind of demon, this kind of sin takes fasting and prayer. But they did not come and ask him, Lord, teach us how to do miracles. Is there a magic wand that we have to wave? Or is there magic words that we need to say? Or is there a certain thing that we need to do? He didn't say none of that. As far as we know, the only request like this that the disciples ever made to Jesus, we find that in Luke 11:1. Lord, teach us to pray. Can you imagine? They were walking with Jesus for all of that time. They saw his teachings. They saw his miracles. But what they really wanted to learn was how to pray. So that's what I want to focus on for a few minutes this morning on, Lord, teach us to pray. What is the discipline of personal prayer that we need to develop so that we can grow our faith, so that we can become better Christians than we've ever been before? So how did Jesus respond? Jesus begins by acknowledging how much prayer is not authentic with many people. His disciples what did they want to do? They wanted to practice prayer. They wanted a certain thing that they could just gurgitate, that they could just magical words. And these things were not authentic. These were not authentic prayers. So Jesus says, hey, let me show you what a prayer model is. So today, to discover that model, I have 7 questions for you. You guys ready to write? I hope you got something, because these, I believe, if you truly focus on these questions, I believe your prayer life will grow. I believe that your faith will grow, and you will truly see how God answers your prayers. But let's use these to evaluate our current health of our prayer life. So not only am I going to learn from these, but I can also use them to evaluate how I've been doing in my prayer walk. So what's the first one? Look at verse 5 and 6. Matthew 6, verse 5 and 6. And when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets, and that they may be seen by men. Surely, I say to you, they have their reward. Wow. Verse 6. But you, when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place, and your Father who sees in the secret will reward you openly. So the first part of it was, is my prayer real, or am I just making a show of it? By the phrase, I don't mean, is it a real prayer? What I mean, is it a prayer genuine, sincere, authentic? It's not that I'm saying that you're not praying, but is it sincere? Are you truly asking for the Lord to bless someone? Or are you just saying the words to make somebody feel good? Is it authentic, and are you sincere in those prayers? If your public prayer exceeds, here, listen very carefully. If your public prayer exceeds your private prayer, and if you prefer it that way, well, you can see how Jesus goes on. Look at what he said on verse 5. And when you pray, don't pray like the hypocrites. Solitary prayer is the mark of a sincere, only seen by you. Listen to what I'm saying. Since solitary prayer, a prayer in secret, Jesus said right here in verse 5, go to a secret place. I'm verse 6. Find yourself a room and close the door. Why do I say that's a sincere prayer? Who goes by themselves into a room and pretend? No one pretends in secret. No one's going to pretend. Nobody's looking around them. You're not pretending. You're actually sincere asking God where and what you're asking for, or seeking God's guidance. When you're in secret, it is sincere. No one does a thing in secret without being sincere. If you did, there's something wrong with you. But now we do things in public. What did Jesus say? Look at the hypocrites. They prayed in public so that people would see. What great prayers. I've asked people to pray in public. Well, I don't know how to pray in public. Open your mouth and talk to God. It's not a rehearsed, perfect, worded prayer. Okay, when you go home, you men, when you go home to your wife after work, what do you do and how do you act upon that? You just say, is food ready? You don't go through a whole long regurgitation of words. You just plainly say, is food ready? Is this ready? Or what do you need? The secret of prayer is prayer in secret. That is what's the key to this. And it is not the public prayer, but the private prayer. Number two, is my prayer simple? Look at verse 7 and 8. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathens do, for they think that they will be heard of for the many words that they speak. The Gentiles thought, well, this is God. This is God is going to like it more if my words are greater and my words are more enthusiastic and if I have all these poetic words. Well, if you turn to 1 Kings 18, we know the story in 1 Kings 18. This is when Elijah was on the mountain and he built the altar and he had all the fire put on there and the wood and the water and the prophets of Baal was sitting there and they were praying. And look at verse 27. And so it was at noon that Elijah mocked them and said, cry aloud, for he is a God. Either he is meditating or he is busy or he is not on a journey or perhaps he's sleeping and must be acknowledged. So they cried aloud and cut themselves as was their custom with knives and lances until the blood gushed out of them. Elijah saying, repeat it, do it louder. And many times we feel that if we're praying to God, the louder we get, maybe we'll get God's attention. God doesn't intend that we need to be yelling and screaming. Now, some of us speak. Some of us get loud. We get excited. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the screaming and the hollering as if, well, the louder I get, then maybe God will hear me. God hears that quiet prayer as well as that enthusiastic prayer. He hears that prayer when you're asking for forgiveness as well as when you're praying for someone's for healing. God is a God of omnipresence. He hears your prayers. We don't need to do like the hypocrites did. It didn't work. The third question, is my prayer worshipful? Look at verse 9. In this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us of our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Is your prayer worshipful? Here says, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Are you worshiping God when you pray? Or are you praying to allow other people to see how godly you are? The short phrase is where often we make a mistake. Jesus wants us to pray, not pray this prayer. This model prayer, the Lord's Prayer as we call it, is not a prayer. It's a model to a prayer. He says, pray this way, honoring God. We're going to talk about that. What does that actually mean? Does that mean we repeat these phrases? It is good to repeat God's word. It is good to memorize God's word. It is good to learn it. But if you're doing this as a prayer, you're missing the point. The point is pray in this manner, not pray this prayer. Jesus wants us to pray, not necessarily this prayer. How do I know that? Each of the lines of the Lord's Prayer points to one category as follows. The prayer expresses recognition. We're saying, may you be recognized. Look what he says. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We are recognizing and we're expressing the recognition that God is the mighty God. I could start off the prayer very simply. Oh, Heavenly Father, you are an outstanding, you are an exceptional God. Oh, Heavenly Father, you are amazing God. I am praying what He is telling me here. I am giving recognition to God. We are saying, may you be recognized, my God, my Creator. Now, that's a category prayer. The names of God. Have you ever used God's name in the prayers to represent what she's talking about with God's personal reputation? So let's look at some of God's names. Yeshua Tzidkenu. Dakanu. Why? Look what God is saying here. Yeshua Yakadish. Yeshua, my God. Yeshua Machadish. I am the one who is changing you, who is touching you out of Leviticus. I am the one here. Are you saying, Yeshua, are you the one that's going to change me? Are you calling them Yeshua Shema? I am the Lord who is there. Are you there? Are you calling Him that you are recognizing that He is the Lord that is there, that He is not hiding someplace? He's not like the prophets of Baal. Maybe when Elijah was teasing them, mocking them. No, are we God? He is our Yeshua Shema, Yeshua Shalom, the God of peace. Is He your God of peace? Or are you praying for peace? Are you calling Him and giving His name to your situation? You might want to study a little bit about the names of God and what it represents, because it's His sovereignty. He is the God. He's got these names because He operates in the different functions of our life. Do we know the names of God? Have we even studied them? Fourth one is my prayer submissive. Look at verse 10. Your kingdom come. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your kingdom, or thy kingdom. The old King James. I love that. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. Whose kingdom are we praying to? Mine or God's? Yours or God's? Who will? Whose will? Is it my will or His will? Is it God's will or your will? Sometimes we pray, we say, our Father who art in heaven, let thy will be done. But Lord, I want it now. I want it this way. I want that. I want this. Who are you praying to? Whose will are you submitting to? Your will or His will? Is your prayer submissive? Is your prayer seeking God? That is one of the things going on in this prayer. Submitting our will to our God, surrendering our territory, our authority over to God. That is what this is saying. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Are you being a submissive prayer? Or are you being a demanding prayer? Are you acting like a two-year-old that didn't get his way and you're throwing a temper tantrum on the floor? What is your prayer and how is your prayer discipline coming? Number five, is my prayer practical? Is it a practical prayer? Look at verse 11. Give us this day our daily bread. So first of all, we start off, we're praising God, calling Him by His name. He is hollow. He is great. Submitting ourselves to God, turning ourselves over to Him. And our prayer is also practical. This is where we kind of put in our little two cents. Our daily bread represents all the basics, all the requirements that we need in life. What is your daily bread? There are four essentials, needs covered by bread that we can pray for. Anybody know what they are? Food, finances, house, covering. Those things are essential needs that we need to cover, that needs to be covered. But also we need our spiritual bread. So we need a practical application, but we also need a spiritual application. I can say, Lord, thank you for my home. Thank you for having a car. Thank you for having a job. But I also say, Lord, thank you for renewing my spirit. Lord, give me this daily bread. Refill me with your spirit. Fill me with your presence. Those four those essential needs are covered by the bread. But it's also the physical and the spiritual. Number six, is my prayer repentant? Are we praying an authentic prayer of repentance. Look at verse 13. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil, from the evil one. Is your prayer authentic repentance? Are you truly coming to the Lord and telling Him things? You know, Lord, I messed up. I made mistakes. Forgive me, Lord, as I forgive the debtors, or I forgive others that sin. Forgive my sins. As I forgive other people that have sinned against me, I ask you, Lord, to forgive me. In my prayers, am I using it in an authentic manner? Or am I asking, Lord, to forgive me my prayers, forgive me my sins, forgive me for what I've done, but punish Him because He offended me? How is the Lord going to forgive you of your sins if you're not willing to forgive others when they sin against you? Is your prayer a repentant? The essence of the Lord's prayer is an attitude of expectation that God does hear, and He does draw near, and He does answer your prayers. But so are you praying a repentance with expectation? Is there an authentic prayer in that expectation? Look at verse 13. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. As an expectation that God is going to deliver us from every evil, every aspect that there is. Are we truly looking at what the Lord has for us? Are we looking for our will to be done on others? Sometimes I've heard prayers that you pray, that you're really not asking God to forgive someone, but you're asking God to punish someone. That is not in the Lord's Prayer. Nowhere in here, in these six verses, in these six areas of the Lord's Prayer, does it talk about an attack. Nowhere does it say, Lord, because I'm a Christian and he offended me, go after him, destroy him. That's not in here. So what is the essence of the Lord's Prayer? Third, the seventh, is my prayer expectant? Do I have an expectation that my prayers will be answered? Our daily bread represents all that basic requirements. Are we truly believing that God's going to answer those prayers? Are we truly going to believe that God is going to give us the things that we need? Are we in expectation? Maybe God says no, but are we in expectation of what God? Do we have the faith that God is going to answer those questions? What are the essentials needed covered by the bread that we need to have? We need to have all of those in our lives. We need to have food, water, shelter. That is true. But we also need to have forgiveness in our prayer. We cannot sit there and ask God to give us a car, but make somebody else walk. How are we going to ask somebody to clothe us? God, clothe me, give me a suit, but let somebody freeze in the wintertime. We have to have a true heart of expectation in our prayers, but expectation in the God's word. God will answer your prayers as long as it's in the will of God. Sometimes for you to have a brand new car, it's not in the will of God, and He's not going to answer it. Sometimes it is. But if you start praying and asking God things that are in His will, I'll guarantee you, you'll start seeing God answering those prayers in a heartbeat. Now, we don't understand sometimes how God answers prayers or the way He answers them. Sometimes He answers them immediately. Sometimes it takes years for you to actually see that prayer. Sometimes it takes a lifetime. I've heard stories of people praying for their husbands, the wives praying for their husbands, 20, 30 years before the husband comes to the Lord. I've heard stories of people praying for a good job years before. Now, sometimes God says, I'll give you the job, but you got to do this. Well, I don't want to do that. I just want the job. I don't want to work hard. I just want the money. Too many people today just have the government give it to me. That's not in the Bible. Lord, help me fill this thing out. No. Now, the help is there, and there's times when the government is there, and God created this country, God created this government, and this government does and have the abilities to help people. There's nothing wrong with that. But it's how our attitude of prayer, where is the authentic prayer in our life? What are we actually looking for? Where are we going? The lamp of the body is the eye. Are we seeing? Are you looking at what God can do? Are you looking at what God has accomplished? Are you praying the prayer of repetition, or are you truly seeking? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as in heaven. Oh, Heavenly Father, you are the mighty God. You're an awesome, great God. You are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. You are my God. I'm giving him the glory. Oh, give us this day our daily bread. Oh, Heavenly Father, Lord, help me with my finances, Lord. Help me that I would be able to accomplish the things that I need to do. Forgive me for my mistakes that I did in my finances. Lord, forgive me for the things that I've done, for the misuse of the stuff that you have given me. I'm using the prayer as a guide to guide me into a prayer. It is not a prayer in itself, but a model to a prayer. How do we go? Forgive us of our sins, or forgive us of our debts, or forgive us of our trespasses, depending on the translation you have. Forgive us. But look at the next part. As we forgive them, or forgive our debtors. So therefore, we cannot be hypocritical here. How can you expect God to forgive you, but you're not going to forgive those? We've offended God, but yet God has forgiven us. Are we willing to forgive those that have offended us? Or are we going to hold a grudge against them? Are we truly looking at this prayer as a model so that we can have a complete model? That's the discipline of this whole lesson that I'm trying to say. What is the discipline of your prayer? Now, many of these prayers that I'm just saying are things that you would do in private. Kind of difficult to go through this many times. And do not lead us in temptation, but deliver us from evil. And I use Isaiah. Oh, Lord, deliver us from evil. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. No evil shall befall me. No plague will ever come into my family. Lord, deliver me from every attacks of the enemy. In this place, give me blessings. Bless my children. Bless my church. Bless my family. Bless my wife. Bless my all the things. Bless my country. I am completely surrendering it to God, saying, you are in control. You are my God. You know why? Because yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. This is why I need a discipline of prayer. This is why I need to reach out and touch and learn how to pray. We can do a lot of things. We learn how to do things. We actually practice our classes and we study. It's all good. But are we learning how to pray? Are we seeking God's wisdom in our prayer life? It doesn't have to have fancy words. Like I was saying earlier, when you go home and you walk into your home, what do you say? Oh, hi, honey. Is supper ready? Or do you say, woman of the house, for thy husband has arrived, and thou shalt have the tables, thou shalt have it prepared, and have the food laid out before me. No. You wouldn't go through a whole conversation with that. You'd say, hey, sweetheart, is dinner ready? Wouldn't you? Or do you go through a whole line of things in your home? Woman of the house, how is thy children doing? Is thy children doing well? Have they had their food? Have they had their shower for before they shall sit at the table and before they shall enjoy the food that has been presented to them, that they shall give the proper thanks to thy ourselves? No. Very simple. Where are the children? Are they hungry? Have they eaten yet? No, they're waiting for you. Okay, let's eat. And we sit down and we give thanks to God for the food that we have, because here is saying it's his will, and it's his will that we have a dinner. It is his purpose, and we ask for our daily bread, and he has provided it for us. That is the prayer. That is what I believe the Lord was trying to tell us in what we call the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you. You are a mighty and an awesome God. Oh, Lord, you touch us in many ways. Lord, do fill us with your spiritual Touch your life, Lord. Fill us with your purpose, O Heavenly Father. Forgive us, Lord, as so many times we have sinned against you, Lord. But give us strength, Lord. Open our eyes that we may see and we may be able to forgive those who have sinned against us. O Heavenly Father, lead us not into this depth of problems, Lord, but take the devil away from us that we are no longer tempted. Strengthen our mind. Put on the armor of God. Protect us, Lord. Your scripture says no weapon formed against us. So, Lord, here we are celebrating you. So deliver us, Lord, from this evil that has attacked our family. Lord, deliver this evil that's attacking our nation right now. Deliver us from these evil men and women that are trying to destroy the church. Oh, deliver those that are trying to destroy our family, our children. Lord, touch them in a mighty way because I trust in you. You are my God. Oh, Lord, you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I surrender myself and I surrender my family. I surrender this church into your hands. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. I want to thank everyone for joining us. I hope that you learn and practice your prayer life. Go in the secret place, find the Lord, and God will transform your life. We're here at First Christian Church, Peru, Indiana. If you need us for anything, just give us a call. We're not telling you to join the church. We're not trying to trick you. We just want you to have a closer walk with Jesus. Can you do that? If you don't know Jesus, that's a simple one. All you have to do is surrender your life. Accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and believe that He died and rose again. We can help you there too, and we can help you to learn more about His Word. Give us a call. If you don't have a Bible, we'll get you one. We're here for you. God bless and have a great day.